Hi friends, I'm Dharmala Shri from Smart Leaders IAS. Prioritize your time, how much time you need to spend for prelims and how far you can spend for the mains and that with this time. And how much you can spend for CSAT or find your weak areas and give more focus towards current affairs also. So prepare well. I'll go to the article now. So today we are going to see about the articles which came on Feb 19th. So there are three topics today. The first topic is, for India, it is neighbourhood first. It is about focusing on neighbourhood first policy. And the next one is about doctors for rural India. It is about providing another short-term course, which is not similar to the National Medical Commission recommendation. It is a new course and highly relevant to our exam. And the next one is directing reforms. It is about recent Supreme Court judgment on disclosing the source of incomes of candidates and their dependents. So this one is a very significant reform with respect to the transparency in the election procedure. We'll go to the article now. So the first article, for India, it is a neighborhood first. So why we need to give much more importance to our neighborhood first policy? In 2014, our Prime Minister made neighborhood first policy. From that time, neighborhood first policy took a new scenario, and the developments have been taken place, and now it is a time to assess. So in 2018 and 19, it can be an assessment year whether the neighborhood first policy is a successful one or a failure one. So this can be one possible area. And also every year we will expect one trouble neighbors question, which was very high in the years of 2013 and 14, and now it is getting reduced because of BRI and the CPEC questions. So the expected area can be neighborhood first policy assessment or the failure, or it is China centric. That is, our neighborhood first policy is a knee-jerk reaction to our big friend. The main crux of the article is, India's immediate neighborhood has to be focused. We can able to balance Israel with Palestine. We are able to balance in the West Asian relation, that is Saudi and Iran. We are able to balance the EU relation. But how far we are balancing our neighborhood relation, it is the most significant one with respect to our geostrategical calculations. Because whatever happenings in our neighborhood, it will affect us directly and indirectly to India. Is there any collapse in Pakistan, security ramifications and the spillover to India? It is a concern for India. And with respect to Taliban in Afghanistan, it is a main concern for India with respect to security. And radicalization in Bangladesh, yes, again, it is a security concern, whether it can be a breeding ground for ISIS or any other radical group, fundamentalist group for India, because it is against for India. And the next one, if there is any political instability continued in Nepal, so it can be a bigger spillover because we are following open border with respect to Nepal. And with respect to Myanmar, insurgents and ethnic problems with respect to Northeast. Northeast has to be developed and through Myanmar, that is our another strategy. And with the crisis deepening in Maldives, whether we are able to solve or it is another prey for China. So these are our main concerns. Because it, in all the ways, whether it is a Hambantota port in Sri Lanka or it is a FTA signed in Maldives, all these are affecting in India in all the ways, socially, economically and culturally, and as a regional power in the Indian Ocean. We are encircled by the string of pearls theory of China. So we need to focus our neighborhood first. This is the main crux of the article. So we cannot afford to continue the engineered chaos which is followed in our neighborhood, and we cannot always follow the Chinese reaction. I mean, we cannot always follow the reactions to the Chinese economic movement in our neighborhood. So what is the analysis part? Here I've told that we should not follow a reaction to China policy. We should engage our neighbors with their own needs and demands and our own needs and demand. So ours should be a bilateral one and not based on or not a China centric, very simply. And the second one is security and the strategical needs of India as well as the neighbors has to be reciprocated. We need not to be a big brother in this area, but we can lend our hand as a big player in the region. So this is our important place here. And the next one is, experts are saying that whether neighborhood first policy is needed at all, because especially when the world is following or very precise America first policy, and why shouldn't we follow India first policy rather than neighborhood first policy? These are also another debatable area. For our country, that is India, if India wants to grow rapidly, it cannot grow alone. It needs the development of our neighbors as well. The next one is dealing with the neighbors. So recent years, India's name was backlash. So this is a one thing. And the second one, with respect to our soft power usage in Afghanistan, which was very well acknowledged by the region. And India has every capability to become a regional player. And it can be proved in the Afghan software $2 billion loan. Our projects were down to earth and it was widely accepted by the people. We need to use diplomacy, dialogue and the soft power to promote good relation with our neighbor. Above all, we are following Gujral doctrine. Gujral doctrine says that without reciprocity, we need to show our generosity to our neighbors, because as a big player in the Indian Ocean, it is our duty to make our neighbors to stand on their own. So without reciprocity, we need to focus on our neighborhood first, as we followed earlier. The next topic is Doctors for Rural India. Here we are going to see a new short-term course for the medical practitioners to work in the rural India. So we will see the expected area. So rural health area can be expected. Already we know that primary health centers are not there and not adequately there. If at all there, they are not working properly, inefficient and so. And access to the healthcare, still it is a dream for 67% of the rural people and 37% of urban people. And the next one expected area can be reforming medical education, because here it says about introducing a new course with updated syllabus. So let us move on to the article. The main crux of the article is the new course is LMP, that is licentiate medical professionals. Licentiate medical professional is not new to the country. It is already practiced from 1942-46 till the Bora committee came into the picture. And the Bora community 1946 recommended the three-tier medical system, that is primary, secondary, tertiary and all. And this is the committee which recommends the MBBS professionals also. They will take care. We need not have this between course, that is 3 to 4 year course of licensure medical professionals. And here Arthur says that we need to implement that one, licensure medical professional, because here we get another chance to update our medical syllabus. Because so far the medical syllabus is not updated and it is not relevant to the needs of our healthcare system. And also vernacular language in the medicines can also be introduced. However, author is worried that in India, if it is cheap, it is equated with the poor quality. But it is not so. These LMP will provide a good good administrators as well as the emergency caretakers in the hospitals, that too especially in the rural areas. And whether we can't have the question that already nurse and pharmacist will be there, whether they can't do the same. Yes, they can do the same. But here, these LMPs will have the higher say. That is an emergency caretaker, or they can report directly to the medical officer. Here, the medical officer will be an MBBS graduates. And rural people need not to be treated like as a second class citizen. That is what the author's opinion now. And the second one is access to primary healthcare. It is still a dream. So it can also be made out. So what are the advantages? According to the author, now MBBS doctors can be focused more towards the medical related works rather than the administrative related works and the data related works. So it can be a bigger one. And the second is focus on inpatient care will be improved, because doctors now will be available to take care of the patients. And the second one is if they are not available, these LMPs will take care. So inpatient care will be increased. And the next one is address the depth of the primary healthcare in India. We know that 8% of our primary healthcare centers are not running are running without doctors. And there are so many single primary healthcare centers, that is only one doctor for the primary healthcare center is available without even any ASHA workers. So this depth of the primary care center in India will be addressed by this LMP. But whether only by improving or implementing this LMP will give you the access to the primary healthcare, actually not so. There are other aspects, because to appoint the LMP in a rural area, especially geographically far distant area, we need infrastructure connectivity first. So that is missing. Infrastructure connectivity not only in terms of hospital construction and all, and the lab facilities, access, that is road connectivity to the hospital, the primary healthcare center, still a dream. In forest areas, in the cases like Chhattisgarh and other tribal dominated areas. And the next one is, we are not utilizing the OIS doctors properly. We need to do so. And instead of providing a new syllabus and in creating a new doctors, already available doctors, already OIS graduates, like they are registered more than 7.7 lakh doctors. So they can be utilized very effectively. So this for the state need to take a step. And the next one is public-private partnership in the healthcare management system. Private has to be engaged in management of information systems, providing lab facilities and any other areas related to the suppliers or kind of so. And the next one is budget 2.5% is our dream, which we address in the national health policy. That is in 2025 we'll achieve that spending to healthcare will be 2.5% of our GDP. But the reality is we need to spend more than 6%. And the next one is auditing. Here, even though we have the primary healthcare center, social auditing, it is missing as of now. We need to focus on the social auditing part. And the next one is quality of the medicines and the quality of the medical care provided by the public hospital, which is not up to the mark. That is why the private hospitals are booming and going unregulated. So this is a major concern that we need to improve in order to provide access to the primary healthcare. The next topic we are going to see is directing reforms. It is about the recent Supreme Court judgment about declaration of source of the income of the candidates in order to improve the transparency in the election. 2017, there was a question about reforms in the Electoral Commission. Election Commission was asked in the mains. So we can expect the Supreme Court judgment with respect to the transparency election. The expected area can be informed electorate and the transparency in the elections. That is candidature will be the key for the future election. So this is a significant and you can expect an essay also in this area. We'll go to the article now. Here, the main crux of the article is Supreme Court judgment itself, because it is very significant and the landmark judgment. And the judgment case is Lok Prahari versus Union of India. Whenever you are writing mains, please make a note of this case and please put it in an organized way of cases when writing a timeline. So here, source of income disclosure is must, not only the candidates, but also his dependents, his spouse and the finances and all. So the question comes, what is the source of the income? How the assets are getting increased? If you are not knowing the source, my right to vote is getting violated. And here the Supreme Court recognizes the right to vote as a fundamental right and the voting is a freedom of expression. Without knowing the information about the candidates, his income, his state, his assets, his rights, citizens' right is getting denied. Court also acknowledges that non-disclosure of assets and their sources is a corrupt practice under the section 123 of Representation of People's Act 1951. That is, if I am not disclosing my assets and not disclosing the source of income, it will be under the corrupt practice. And if it is a corrupt practice, I cannot take part in the election and my seat is getting, I will be disqualified under the section 123 of Representative People Act 1951. And now we know the famous cases with respect to this one. And the next one is informed electorate and the transparency in the candidature. It is a key for our future election. Because our electoral system is getting reformed and reformed. Before there is a ballot vote system and we started the Representation of People Act and the electoral funding also we are getting started and everywhere transparent we are able to promote and the VVPAT machines, next version of VVPAT machines, everything is moving towards the free and fair elections in the largest democracy. It is a significant judgment and it can be highly relevant for our UPSC exam. Association Democratic Reforms versus Union of India put a case and from this income disclosure becomes mandatory. I repeat, Association Democratic Reformation, it is an NGO, it made a case in the Supreme Court from this judgment only, income disclosure becomes a mandatory one. The next one is Section 29C1A of Representative People Act 1951. Here, exception to the political party. Here, the role of political party, we need to get a note of it because the political parties here, they need not to show their income up to 20,000. So it is a loophole or I can say the drawback and the Supreme Court judgment, the reason one, it is not getting fulfilled unless and until this section 29(1)(c)(a) is to be nullified. Next one is electoral bonding. Here, electoral bonding, electoral funding mechanism, we need not to disclose the source of income. So this is another loophole according to the author and he says that electoral funding will only increase the money flow, that is illegal money flow or whether legal money flow, but it will not promote the transparency in the funding mechanism. So this is the main concern of the author. Here, author wants to show that how the party in India, it is highly related to the candidate. In this Kehato case, in 2016, I think it is asked in the mains question. And here, disqualification of an MP or MLA, it was permissible when he is disobeyed the party's rules or the directions. So party is the main holder in India, and the MPs and the MLAs are part of the party. Funding goes to the candidate via party. It need to be a transparent one rather than keeping it in under record. So these are the main areas need to be focused for reformations or funding mechanism and the transparency in the election. I repeat, informed electorate and the transparency in the candidature will be the key for the future elections. Put your plans in a very flexible way and do it accordingly. All the very best.